So do spirochetes have the same kinds of tubes inside them? It's a question that Professor Margulis is currently trying to answer.
We have enough material. The usual problem with all the protozoa, outnumbering the spirochetes.
As a first step, she's had to build a termite colony in her laboratory. It's the only way she can get a regular supply of spirochetes.
Okay. I hope we'd gone it here. I don't know whether we have enough or not, but let's just take a look. And we can carry on them. I haven't seen any of them, but they crawl inside.
The spirochetes live inside termites, and the termites live inside blocks of wood.
Let's break it, yeah. We've got them. They really go inside. Oh, boy, oh, there they are. That. We've got hundreds of them. Take a brush. Oh, here. Hundreds. One, two, three, four. No. They ought to be loaded with spirochetes. They're all workers.
The work going on here is controversial. Many experts think spirochetes are too primitive, too far down the evolutionary tree to have microtubules. But if they're found in these wriggling creatures, it could fundamentally change our ideas about how life evolved. The first results here are encouraging. This electron microscope picture shows a cross-section through a spirochete. In the center are distinctly tube-like structures, these thin gray lines. But are they proper microtubules? More experiments must be done before we can be sure. It's an important question because microtubules are involved in some fundamental processes of life. Building a frog or even a worm needs a very complicated plan. Every time a cell divides, this plan has to be exactly duplicated. This genetic information is in the chromosomes, these dark threads. During cell division, the chromosomes have to be split into two identical bundles and transported to each of the daughter cells. Simple cells, bacteria, can't divide in this way. Complex cells can, and they use microtubules to help sort out and transport these unwieldy collections of chromosomes.
The genetic material itself, if it were that skinny, say, just about that skinny, would, for one chromosome of a person, stretch all the way to from London to, say, Land's End. And this whole thing is packaged into a very tight package about 8 feet long. Now, that thing has to be moved. Bacteria and blue-green algae can't do this. And what happens is this package of genes is moved by things called microtubules. Well, these microtubules turn out to be identical in chemistry and in substructure to the microtubules of cilia and flagella. I think that gives us a hint as to their origin. Microtubules started out in cilia and flagella as structures of them. And then as the cilia and flagella were drawn into the cell, these microtubules were used in many, many ways. And one of the major ways was for the division of the genes, the division of the DNA.
If Professor Margulis is right, and microtubules originally came from spirochetes, it means this kind of cell division developed through symbiosis. This was a turning point. Once cells could pass on large bundles of genetic instructions, all of the complex forms of life began to emerge. Symbiosis is still at work, maintaining life even at the highest levels. Without the help of